Welcome back on board for another session. So this time we want to talk with you about seagrass. And seagrass is not always the same as seagrass. So first of all, you gotta understand the big difference between algae and seagrass. Algae is always on some solid substrate, meaning on rocks, because it has so-called suction plates to basically attach itself to the bottom. Seagrass, on the other hand, is an actual plant, just like any plant on land, and it has roots. So therefore it needs sand, mud, some sort of sediment to grow its roots into. Some of them can also grow into the rock, but that would be very rough rock where they can actually attach with the roots. Now, here in the Mediterranean, we have three pretty common kinds of seagrass. One of them being Cymodotia, second one being Zostera, and the third one, Poseidonia. Now, the first two, Cymodotia and Zostera, are really annual seagrasses. So they're pretty small, very thin leaves, and basically every year in spring they start growing from new. The roots remain in the underground, but the grass itself starts from scratch every single year. Poseidonia, on the other hand, is a multi-year seagrass. So that means it never stops growing. It does slow down in the wintertime, it speeds up again in the summertime, but it grows really year round. And that also makes the meadows incredible.
We said this is very slow growing species. The origin, actually, the Poseidonia oceanica is the endemic for Mediterranean, and another Poseidonia species are in around Australia, in the more or less temperate area in Australia, temperate sea or Australia, not in tropical part. And actually the evolution of this Poseidonia begin with other Poseidonia species. So it was during the Tethys time. Tethys Sea was big, almost global Earth Sea, and in temperate area, Poseidonia became from land species. It was grass. It was grass. Became aquatic species, and during the history, the continents would just dividing, actually closing and going. Well, here and there, and Poseidonia needs to have shallow because of the light. They are growing in just shallow, down to maybe 40, 50 meters in Mediterranean. And Australia is more or less the same. So then, as the continents were setting apart, I would say one Poseidonia species, I don't know about. Maybe what's more, but one Poseidonia species go on the north hemisphere and the other we just pulled with Australia continent to the south hemisphere. And the Mediterranean actually is the, you can say, the older part, the oldest part of Tethys Sea. So actually the Mediterranean was once almost completely dried out, but actually it's the basin of Mediterranean is the history, it's in Tethys. So the Poseidonia left from that area here.
The way the seagrass is set up is that it has the roots on the bottom, then it has what's called the rhizome, so it's this brown layer in the middle, and then on the top you have the actual leaves. Now, the leaves themselves grow incredibly fast. They can do like a few centimeters in a month, but the rhizome grows incredibly slow.
When you have Poseidonia, Poseidonia is growing few rhizomes and a few rhizomes and a few rhizomes, and we call that mate. it's just a layer of rhizomes below the the meadow that you have now. In that rhizomes you have, it's very, very old. So we have 1 millimeter per year, or 1 centimeter rising of rhizomes in 10 years. Or 100 years. But it's very, very slow procedure. And in some parts of Croatia, even here on outside of the island, we have that mate that is 70, 80, maybe 1 meter of height. So it means that it's very old meadow. It's another thing which is good if we are going back to climate change. That meadow, especially that the layer below that, it's a big carbon accumulator. So it's Posidonia, it's carbon sink, and that's why it's very, very important. If you remove the upper layer of alive Posidonia, for example with anchoring, you would reach to lower layers, and with the sedimentation, with the waves and everything, you would actually put that carbon again in flux. And when you put it in flux, after some while, it will be end up in the air like a carbon dioxide, and it will just make the global change, making it faster.
Nature strives to have some kind of balance. For now, our moment in time, this is the balance that we have now, but we see that it's really, really iffy. That it's because we've already lost a whole bunch of things, and probably there's a lot of it that we lost that we didn't even know that existed, that hasn't been seen, that hasn't been researched, that hasn't been recorded. But for the things that we do know that it is here, especially the things that we know that are important, for example, Posidonia meadows, what will happen if we lose them? We know this, that we won't have that many fishes, that it's the first thing that people will notice. We won't have that good visibility of water. We won't have so stable the coast, because Posidonia meadows are also helping to stabilize the coast and to not that have so many erosions. What will we do? Will we put concrete everywhere because we ruined meadows of Posidonia? We already put concrete into many places. We will have probably a decline in number of species that live the sea, just because we lost that one key species. Posidonia is a canopy species, it's a keystone species, and a lot of points in my life I have heard that actually 25% of all marine organisms that live in the Mediterranean in some point of their life are actually living in Posidonia. And we all know how that works. If you just take one part of your life, if you didn't had, let's say, a stable home while growing up, if you weren't born in that hospital that you were, like, everything is changing.
Now, when it comes to the things that seagrass is doing for us, there's a couple of things really we should keep in mind. First of all, talking about climate change, seagrass is an incredible carbon sink. Seagrass as a carbon sink is actually up to 50 times more efficient than planting trees on land. The other thing that seagrass is doing incredibly well is holding substrate. So if you are from any country with mountains like Austria, anywhere on the mountainsides, usually there's trees. And if we cut down the trees, there's no roots holding the sediment, so every time it rains a lot, there's mudslides coming down the mountains. Underwater, it's basically a similar story. Now, we don't have huge sand mountains underwater, but still the roots of the seagrass stabilize the substrate incredibly. So that means if the seagrass is gone, our sandy beaches will just wash away with the waves. So yet another important role of the seagrass. And of course, seagrass is also an incredible breeding ground. So not only do fish go there to breed and to have the juveniles, but also it's an amazing nursery. So if you ever dive into a seagrass meadow, have a closer look around and you'll find hundreds of little fish, little crustaceans, of all sorts of juveniles of many different species.
In every spot we have three sites based on the exposure. We put this on a rock at the coastline and then we go 50 meters into the bay, kind of 50 meters, and then we check where the rock starts, where there's sand and where there's Posidonia, and we all write it down to see throughout the years if it's changing.
The seagrass are kind of the lungs of the sea. They provide shelter for a lot of the animals. So seagrass is also really important because it functions as a carbon sink. So on the land we have the rainforest and all types of trees, and underwater we basically have different ecosystems that function in that same way. So we have the most productive ones are mangroves and seagrasses, and if we lose them, that also means that a lot of carbon will get released into the ocean and in the atmosphere as well. So that's why it is important that we keep them protected.
Posidonia is declining. It's declining because of eutrophication. So the sea is not so transparent. Eutrophication is the process when you have lots of organic matter in the sea. So it's used by phytoplankton, so primary production, phytoplankton, zooplankton, and you have actually a lot of things in the water column that block the sun. So this is one of the things that Posidonia is really, really sensitive to. Another thing is human impact. I would say anchoring or aquaculture above the Posidonia meadows is the problem. The problem with Posidonia is that recover is very, very slow, but very, very slow. So you need 1 year per 1 centimeter to have the meadow spread. So for 100 meters of meadow, you need 100 by 100, 10,000 years. So it's a huge amount of time. And in 10,000 years from now, it would be really, 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 we cannot say what. Climate change would go, we don't know where. So it's definitely it's declining. It's declining by, I think it's 30 or 40% now from people were from the time when people start to record. And I think it's slowing down. So the most sensitive parts are already dead. This is not so good thing. Another thing that people, you can say Western European Union and Mediterranean countries start to appreciate the Posidonia. Posidonia is Mediterranean endemic species, but we have here, we have Asia, we have Africa, and we have Europe, who is actually dealing with Posidonia on one way or another way. People, they changed their minds from last 40 years. So I think that declining of Posidonia will stop, and it stop or just really slow down, especially in this European countries, because there are lots of Natura 2000 sites that are actually the Posidonia. Their like habitat is protected. They are Natura 2000 just because of Posidonia. So we were just on one today, and Posidonia is in good shape there, and it will be. So in those area, because EU regulations, they said you need to have really good reason and really good study of those that Posidonia if you want to make some construction there or to do something. So it's really, now it's, I think the mental thing is changed.
Clean the ocean. If you see any plastic or something, just take it out and don't throw anything into the sea if it's not belong there.
So if you live close by the sea, please just cherish everything that you see when you're snorkeling or being in the sea, and take good care of it. Don't leave any rubbish behind or pollute the water, because it's an amazing world underwater, and probably in a few years it will look very different and will be less colorful. And so just, if you have the chance to take a look, please do so and leave it clean.